Hello students, welcome to Wisdom Academy. I am Nasreen and today we will be continuing with our chapter Halo Compounds. In this session we are going to see what are properties like physical property, chemical property and some mechanism. So already we have seen nomenclature, classification, preparations and CX bond type also. So in this session we will see what are their properties. So first we will start with physical property. So physical property, first their physical state, that is most of them, smaller members are gas and higher members will be liquid, some will be even solid, like most of the halo arene compound, like with benzene rings, they will be solid in nature. And then the second point is their solubility in water. Usually organic compounds are insoluble in water, most of the organic compounds are insoluble, but because they have some partial polarity, they have solubility, but it is very slightly soluble, but they are fully soluble in organic solvents like ether, acetone, etc. So this is based on their solubility. The third point is their CX bond length. So this bond length depends on the halogen atom attached. If it's fluorine, the electronegativity is more, so the bond length will be very very less. But if you take less electronegative atom like bromine, iodine, the electron pulling will be less, so the bond length will be high. So if electronegativity is high, bond length will be less. So the order of bond length is iodo compound, then bromo compound, then chloro, the last one is fluoro. And this is the order of the boiling point, because for boiling point, if the bond length is very less, it is very difficult for the compound to break in between them. So iodo has very high boiling point, then bromo, then chloro, then fluoro. This is for the boiling point. Then the last one comes is the melting point. Melting point, we can take three isomer like para, ortho and meta. So para, we have two halogen on the exact opposite side. Ortho, we have nearby substitution. In meta, we have alternate position substitution. So in this three isomers, in para we have symmetry. That is, if we cut into two equal halves, one half will be the mirror image of the other one. So this is has exact symmetry, so this is more stable. So whenever you have symmetry, the isomer will be very stable. But in ortho and meta, we don't have that much symmetry. So para will be having very high melting point compared to ortho and meta. So this is regarding the physical property of halo compounds. Now we will move on to the chemical properties. In chemical properties, before getting into the reaction, we need to know five important topic. That first one is chirality, then SN1 reaction, SN2 reaction, E1 and E2 reaction. These five reactions or mechanism we need to know first. First we will start with chirality. Consider you have two carbon molecules like so. In this carbon, it is attached with four different groups. So one is methyl, bromine, chlorine, fluorine. Here it is attached with three different group, but the fourth one is same as chlorine. So it is attached with two chlorine, one fluorine and one bromine. This carbon is chiral and this is achiral. That means achiral is the carbon which is attached with four different groups. This carbon is called achiral carbon or asymmetric carbon. We have many names for this. So this whole chirality is regarding this achiral carbon. So this carbon should be attached with four different groups. Then only the phenomena called chirality will be applied for that molecule. Now we will see some terms in this chirality. First, there are two things. First one is mirror image. So we have something like a butterfly. It is a mirror image. That is, if you cut into two equal halves, one half will be the mirror image of the other one. So this is mirror image. The next one is superimposable. So when we have your hand, so if I place like this, the hand behind this front one, we cannot see from the front view. So this is called superimposable. If I place like this, so here I have my thumb and this one. So this is not superimposable. So we have second point which we want to know is superimposable. So first one is mirror image, and the second one is superimposable. So in chiral compounds, you have two types. In the first one is enantiomers. The condition for enantiomer compound, these are isomers which are non-superimposable and mirror image of each other, like if you take any compound like this. So we have first one, we need to check for chirality. This is a chiral carbon because it is attached with four different groups. This is the second isomer. Here, this carbon and this carbon, so fluorine, fluorine, chlorine, chlorine. So these are mirror image. So here the chlorine is on the right hand side, but here the chlorine is on the left hand side. Bromine, then iodine. So these two isomers form exact mirror image. So first condition is valid. Second one is it should be non-superimposable. So when you place this isomer exactly on above this first isomer, fluorine, carbon, iodine will be superimposable, but chlorine and bromine will not be superimposable because this chlorine and this bromine are different atoms. These two are different atoms. Fluorine, fluorine, carbon, carbon, iodine, iodine are superimposable, but this bromine and this chlorine are not superimposable, and this chlorine and this bromine also not superimposable. So these two isomers are mirror image and non-superimposable. So they are enantiomers. So for enantiomers, we have two conditions. First one is they should have mirror image relation. Second one is they should be non-superimposable. This is the first type, enantiomers. The second type is diastereomers. Diastereomers, the first condition is it should have minimum two chiral carbon. In enantiomers, we have seen only one chiral carbon, but diastereomers, you should have two chiral carbon. It should not be a superimposable isomers. Third one, they should not be even mirror image also. Consider this is one isomer. This carbon is chiral, hydrogen, chlorine, bromine, carbon, all the four are different. This carbon is also chiral, methyl, OH, fluorine, carbon. So both the carbon are chiral carbon. Consider this is to be is isomer. So the first condition is it should have two chiral carbon. Both isomers have two chiral carbon. The second one is they should be non-superimposable. This two, first carbon, this part, this part is superimposable, but the second part is non-superimposable. We have to look into the whole molecule. Even if one chiral carbon is non-superimposable, at the whole they are considered to be non-superimposable. So those two isomers are non-superimposable. Third condition, they should not even be mirror image. The second chiral carbon is mirror image, but the first chiral carbon is not mirror image. They are superimposable, so they are not mirror image. So even the third condition has been satisfied. So they should have two chiral carbon, they should be non-superimposable. third one, there should be not even mirror image in the isomers. So this is regarding diastereomers. Now we have seen what is chirality, enantiomers and diastereomers. Now we will move on to mechanism. Before getting into the mechanism, we need to know some terms. So I have studied two isomers. So this isomers is nothing but, there are two types of isomers. One is D isomer, another one is L isomer. So we have D isomer and L isomer. So these are two isomers. If the both the isomers have 50% and 50%, both are in equal composition, then it is called racemic mixture. It is called racemic mixture, and the process of preparing this racemic mixture is called racemization. So you have two isomers, D isomer and L isomer. This terms D is for dextrorotatory, L is for levorotatory. So dextrorotatory, levorotatory, basically this is given by experiment. Okay. So usually you have any substance and you pass a light. When you pass a light, if the light comes out of a solution without any deviation from its path, then this substance is optically inactive. Optic means light. So optically inactive means the chemical substance doesn't have any interaction with the light. But when the light direction changes to either left or right, then the substance is called optically active because it has changed the path of light towards left or right. If the light changes direction towards right, it is dextrorotatory. If it changes towards left, it is levorotatory. So hence we have two isomers, dextrorotatory and levorotatory. So these are two isomers. If the two isomers are in equal composition, that is called racemic mixture, and the process of preparing this racemic mixture is called racemization. So these are the terms you need to know. Now we'll move on to nucleophilic substitution reaction. Nucleophile is a species which has negative charge. Even you have some neutral nucleophiles also, but you will attack the carbon with positive charge. They are called nucleophiles. So here we have two types of nucleophilic substitution reaction. One is SN1, another one is SN2. So this N represents nucleophile, substitution reaction. One is unimolecular. Now we will get into the reaction. So you have a hollow compound, it reacts with any reagent. We take water as example, you get alcohol and HX. So this is the substituted product, this is reagent and this is the product, and here in water OH minus is the nucleophile. Okay. So now in mechanism we have two steps. First step is the formation of carbocation. In 11th standard we have seen what is carbocation, carbanion, carbene. If the carbon possesses positive charge, it is carbocation. If it has negative charge, it is carbanion. If it has only one electron, it is carbene. So it should have form carbocation, which is the intermediate. The second one is the nucleophile will attack the carbocation, which is the substitution reaction. First one, we take the halo compound RX, it dissociates into heteronuclear dissociation fission into R plus and X minus. So this R plus is nothing but carbocation in which carbon possesses positive charge, and this is the intermediate. Okay. So here we have something called rate determining step. So we have many steps for one reaction. For example, if A needs to give D, A have to give B, B to C, C to D. So for A to give D, you have to pass three steps. So this is called complex reaction. So in this three step, one step will be very very slow. That is called rate determining step, because that step will tell you how much time is required to complete this reaction. Okay. So the rate determining step is very important because that decides the time for the reaction to get complete. So here the formation of carbocation step is the rate determining step. Okay. So now second step is attacking of nucleophile, that is the R plus reacts with the nucleophile, it forms product which is alcohol over here. Now we have one, that is unimolecular, that is because how much reagent is present in RDS will decide the rate of the reaction. Like in RDS we have only one reagent RX, so it is unimolecular. So this one represents unimolecular because in RDS rate determining step we have only one reagent. So this is regarding mechanism of SN1 reaction. First one is formation of carbocation, which is rate determining step. Second one is attacking of nucleophile, which is very fast step. Now we will go on to stereochemistry, like in three dimensional region how it looks. We all know carbon, sp3 carbon has tetrahedral shape. This is the tetrahedral shape. In tetrahedral shape, consider the axis behind the plane. If we take that as d isomer, we don't know, but we just assume it has a d isomer. So this is the intermediate in which x is removed. This is the carbocation. So when tetrahedral is converted to carbocation, it forms trigonal planar. All the three carbons will be on the plane, so it forms trigonal planar. Now R plus is trigonal planar. When nucleophile comes and attacks the carbon center, if it's on the plane, it has two options. One is the nucleophile will come and attack from the above the plane or from the below the plane region. So it has two chances. If it attacks from the region where leaving group has left, so it is d isomer. But if it comes and attacks from the opposite side, then it is a l isomer. So we have two possible options. If it's attacked from the same side from where the leaving group has left, then it is d isomer. If it's attacked from the opposite side, then it is l. So we have, it has equal opportunity, so it forms 50%. It also forms 50%. We have already seen 50D, 50L is racemic mixture. So SN1 is racemization process. So this is regarding SN1 reaction. Now we'll move on to SN2 reaction. So here in this mechanism, it is only one step mechanism, because before the leaving group leave the carbon center, nucleophile will come and attack. See, X has not even left the carbon center, but OH has started to attack the carbon center. This is called transition state. In SN1 we have intermediate, in SN2 we have transition state. Now since X is still in the molecule, OH cannot come through this side, so OH has to attack the carbon center from the opposite side. So no other option, we have only opposite configuration. If you are starting with D, it will end with L, so there is no possible option. So this is called inversion. If we get product which is only the opposite of the isomer configuration, then that is called inversion, and this type of inversion is called Walden inversion. So this is Walden inversion. In SN1 we have racemization, in SN2 we have Walden inversion. So now we will move on to intermediate and transition state difference. Intermediate we can isolate, see, we can tell it is trigonal state, planar state or any other geometry, but in transition state we cannot isolate, we can just assume. So this is the thing, leaving group has not left, but OH has attacked, so it is very unstable, hence we have written this in bracket. So this is regarding SN1 and SN2. Now we will come to the halo compounds reacting in SN1 and SN2 mechanism. SN1, first the leaving group have to leave, then the incoming group will, that is nucleophile, will come and attack. So the order is tertiary carbon will undergo SN1 very soon, then secondary, the last priority is primary, because in tertiary carbon it is very crowded. So being very crowded, it will prefer to leave first, then the incoming group will come. Here it is already crowded, so OH has no possibility to come and attack this carbon. So only SN1 is possible. In SN2, it is very free, because on one side you can come and attack. So this is for primary, then secondary and tertiary. Because tertiary cannot undergo SN2 reaction, because already it is crowded. So if you come and attacking with the fifth group, it is not at all possible. So the order is primary, then secondary, then tertiary. Secondary products have both the possibilities, but tertiary can undergo, 90% can undergo SN1, and the primary can undergo only SN2 mechanism. So this is regarding SN1 and SN2 mechanism. Order of SN1 is tertiary, secondary and primary. Order of SN2 is primary, secondary and tertiary. This is regarding SN1 and SN2 mechanism. In SN1 we have two step, formation of carbocation, attacking of nucleophile. The geometry will be, the isomers will be forming racemization. In SN2, we have transition state, that is only one step mechanism. Here we have only Walden inversion. Whatever isomer we take, we get exactly the opposite configuration isomer. So this is regarding SN1 and SN2 mechanism. So now we will move on to elimination reaction. In elimination also we have E1, E2. Here, first we will take any halo compound. If we base is any reagent, base is very strong, then the first thing is it will abstract a proton from the beta carbon. So the halogen attached carbon is alpha and the carbon attached to the alpha carbon is beta carbon. Here we have two beta carbon. So we will get two carbocation. One, when the proton is subtract from this carbon, we have one carbocation, and if proton is subtract from this carbon, we have the second carbocation. So we have two carbocation. Now when the halogen is removed, then we will have two types of two products. One will be major product, another one will be minor product. Now this is decided by the stability of carbocation. The stability of carbocation is tertiary is very stable, then secondary, then primary. So here this carbocation is primary carbocation and this carbocation is secondary carbocation. So the secondary carbocation will give you the major product. When bromine is removed, this bond will shift here, so it's double bonded. So then when this carbocation bromine is removed, they form minor product. So you have two types of product, major product and minor product, and this rule is called Zaitsev rule. So in Zaitsev rule, the bromine is removed and it forms highly substituted alkene. So we have two types of alkene. Substituted alkene means the olefinic carbon should have many substitution. In this olefinic carbon, this carbon have substitution, one substitution, but this carbon have no substitution, only hydrogen. So this is less substituted. But here this carbon also have one substitution and this carbon also have one substitution. So this is highly substituted olefin. So in Zaitsev rule, elimination will takes place and the product will have, major product will have highly substituted alkene. So this is Zaitsev rule. So next comes E2 mechanism. Here the abstraction of proton and removal of halogen takes place in single step. As SN2, E2 also takes place in one single step. So directly it forms the product. So it gives, more or less it gives only one product. So this is E1 and E2. E1 follows Zaitsev rule, where E2 takes place in one single step. E2, E1 is also called beta elimination reaction because beta proton is removed from this. So this is called elimination reaction with mechanism. So in this session we have seen chirality, nucleophilic substitution reaction, elimination reaction. Now we will see some reactions. Now what is the possibilities? If you have primary, it will undergo only SN2 because primary is very less steric hindrance, so it undergoes SN2. Elimination will takes place when it is highly crowded. But we know primary molecule is not crowded, it is attached with only one carbon, so the carbon molecule is not that much crowded, so it undergo possibly only SN2. It undergoes SN2 and elimination both. Possibility is equal, so undergoes SN2 and elimination, where tertiary undergo SN1 and elimination. So these are the possibilities. Primary will undergo SN2, secondary SN2 and elimination, tertiary SN1 and elimination. So whenever you see the halo compounds, we have to tell with the reagent what are the different products it can form. Like if it has methyl bromide, methyl bromide is a primary halo compound, it has no way to it undergo elimination reaction. But when you have something like isopropyl chloride, so this carbon is secondary carbon. So being secondary carbon, it has two options. It can either undergo substitution reaction or not it undergo elimination reaction. So there are two options. So here, so if we take very strong base, whenever the base is very strong, it will undergo elimination reaction. this is the product for elimination. But if it's a very good nucleophile, if that's our reagent we are taking is very good nucleophile, it then need to undergo SN2 reaction. So this is SN2 reaction. So the reaction which it depends on the base or nucleophile which is present in the reaction mixture. So this is regarding secondary carbon. If it's tertiary carbon, same, it undergo SN1 or elimination. So this is regarding reactions of halo compounds. It has given two important reaction. First one is Wittig reaction. So now we will start with Woods. So we have two types, one is Wittig, one is Woods. We have third type called Wittig and Woods, both will be combined in the reaction. If it's Woods, we have to take halo compound. This is alkyl halo compound 2 and 2 sodium. So sodium is important. That solvent here is dry ether. This X is removed with Na as NaX, and the alkyl which we have taken will bond with each other and forms alkane. So this is called Woods reaction. The second one is formation of OMC, that is organometallic compounds. So when it reacts with any strong metal like magnesium, it forms RMGX. This is very important reagent called Grignard reagent, because it serves as a raw material to produce many other chemical substance. Like when treated with water, it forms alkane. So this R with one H, and the OH will go with magnesium. This is the substance which we get as side product, but an important compound which has formed is alkane, which is the application of Grignard reagent. So any metal with alkyl group is called organometallic compound. Grignard reagent is one of the example in that. So we have Woods reaction, in which alkyl halo compound reacts with sodium, forms alkane. And the second one is halo compound reacts with any strong metal like magnesium, and they form organometallic compound. So these are the reactions of alkyl halogen compound. So we have already seen the properties, chemical properties with mechanism. In the coming session, we will be seeing the chemical properties of haloarenes. So we have nomenclature, classification, preparation, properties. And next session, we will be also seeing the uses, useful compounds like CFC, all those things. So here the mechanism is similar for alkyl group, and we have some different mechanism for aryl group because they have benzene ring in that, and those topics we will be seeing in the next class. Thank you. Subscribe to our channel, like the video, share with your friends.